Joining us right now is Mark Noble from Horizons ETFs. Mark, it's great to chat with you.
Always fun, Pierre.
So, Mark, what's been happening in the fixed income space?
Well, a lot of people don't know that fixed income in the Canadian ETF market is a massive amount of assets. So globally, about 7 to 15% of any given domestic market has fixed income as an asset allocation.
Yeah.
In Canada, we're looking at 30%. So one out of every $3 in Canada is invested in fixed income. Now there's some really key reasons for that. The big one being just the fact that the Canadian fixed income market has been very tightly controlled by the OTC dealers. And I don't have anything against the banks, but they've had a good business of running high commission bonds. So ETFs have basically, by their nature, are a security that trades like a stock. So they create liquidity for fixed income. And Canadians have really tweaked on to buying historically a lot of fixed income and using ETFs to get exposure to that. So a lot of the growth actually that we talk about in the Canadian market over the last 3 or 4 years for the ETF market specifically has been ETF flows. But they've been sort of buying anything fixed income.
Right.
And of course, there's been no repercussions for that. And so for the
not for 35 years.
No, exactly. So, you know, I usually like equate it to, you know, Game of Thrones, where that came out 8 or 9 years ago and you had Ned Stark saying, you know, winter's coming, and through the whole show, they're saying winter's coming. Well, for sort of the same time horizon, we've said, you know, interest rates are coming, but if you know, started shorting things with interest rates, you know, 7 years ago when people started talking about this, it's been a terrible trade.
Yeah.
However, you know, winter is here. Interest rates are here.
Yeah.
And what we've seen this year is a huge reversal in the fact that people are looking at their portfolio statements, particularly in October, and saying that the equity market's down 8 to 10%, and their fixed income is down 2 to 3%. And in fact, on the broad aggregate bond ETFs, which represent the largest asset class of fixed income, they're negative on a two-year basis. So this is really unprecedented territory for investors.
Yeah, it's kind of a rude awakening.
It is.
I think the October surprise with U.S. yields on the 10-year rising above 3.2 was a real wake-up call for the market as well.
Exactly. And then you had another thing happening, which is that you had credit spreads also widening. So now you have people concerned about earnings growth and some of the situations now looking at what's happening globally with trade and saying, you know, fixed income credit spreads have been really tight. And overweighting credit versus government has been a fantastic play because you're generally getting, even still, you know, 100 to 150 basis points of additional yield, depending what class you're in. But those blew out as well. So there was really nowhere to hide in fixed income last month, except for extraordinarily short-term bonds. And so now, of course, we've seen all of the asset flows move into ultra short-term bonds. Record flows in the U.S. into ultra short-term bonds. It was really the only positive asset class in Canada. But there's some caveats.
This is what's been driving up the dollar.
Correct.
I mean, that's also having a dire, that's causing a dire reaction on earnings, on the earnings side as well, right? Where you've got the strong dollar having an impact on what would have been otherwise great results.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And so this has been, you know, this focus on the short term, it makes sense from a portfolio perspective, but now, you know, you're probably looking at a crowded space.
Yeah.
So the question is, on a go-forward basis, is like, what the heck do I do in my fixed income portfolio? And this is a real challenge, particularly for advisors, because they have to ask themselves, you know, the one part of my portfolio where I really didn't have to take client phone calls was fixed income.
Yeah.
And the one part of my portfolio that's gone from 35 to maybe 50, 60% because of the demographic shift in clients is fixed income.
Right.
So this is a real conundrum for investors. I think what we work a lot in the active fixed income space. We're the largest provider of actively managed fixed income ETFs in Canada. We work with Fiera Capital, which is one of the largest fixed income managers in Canada. You know, really what they're saying is, you know, despite this pause out in what we've seen with the losses in fixed income, you want to look at a few key areas. And number one, understand that you probably still want to look at credit relative to governments, just because of the fact that you did get the credit spreads widening, and that even impacted things like preferred shares.
Right.
However, you know, you want to be looking at holding, you know, investment grade, probably relative to high yield, just because of the fact that as you get into a late cycle, you're looking at a lot more risk on these balance sheets.
Sure, you want to move to the quality side of the market.
So that's a big focus. And then the other one, is, of course, to keep looking at short duration. The problem is what are you looking at when you look at short duration? So we've seen flows in two different areas. We've seen them in ultra short, almost cash-like investments. Now remember, when you move to cash-like or ultra short term investments like floating government bonds, your yield is not a whole lot. Now, of course, it increases with interest rates, but it does create a gap for advisors, because I find that most advisors I talk to are looking for about a 4% target yield for their portfolio, which intuitively should make sense. If I got $1 million portfolio, 4% is going to give me $40,000 a day.
Sure, that's the withdrawal rate.
But if I'm getting 1.5, maybe 2 from government fixed income that's ultra short duration, yeah. I mean, that's really tough to try to build those analysis. So what we see is a lot of advisors gravitating towards short interest, high yields. And that's been a great trade, but it's primarily focused on senior loans. The issue is just that you've also got the credit risk there. And now what we've seen is that high yield credit risk volatility, particularly with credit spreads, has started to widen out. So, you have this challenge as an advisor where it's a good idea to try to chase the 4%, and maybe senior loans are a great thing to have in there. Some of these are yielding 5-6% even.
Yeah. Until they're not.
Yeah. And the point is, if you get a huge widening of spreads or risk occurring, well, then you run into the same issue again. So I think I've never seen it so challenging for advisors, where they sort of have to be looking at barbelling their ETF approach, where you have some of this ultra short investment grade, yeah. and then you're trying to look at how do I find the additional 2 to 3 percentage points of spread, and you're probably looking at barbelling it. But the problem is, you don't want to be all senior loans. You don't want to be all short-term fixed income. You've got to find an amalgam of ETF strategies to put together to get to that 4%.